It gives me great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker tonight, Dr. Timothy Tennent, President of Asbury Theological Seminary. An ordained minister of the United Methodist Church, Dr. Tennent is highly regarded as a theological educator as well as an internationally recognized missiologist who combines biblical fidelity with cultural sensitivity and missional passion. Before assuming the presidency at Asbury in 2009, Dr. Tennent served for 11 years as Professor of World Missions and Indian Studies here at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, our host for this consultation. Dr. Tennent received his MDiv in 1984 from Gordon-Conwell and a THM in Ecumenics with a focus on Islam from Princeton Theological Seminary. He did graduate work in linguistics at the University of Georgia before completing his PhD in non-Western Christianity with a focus on Hinduism and Indian Christianity in 1998 at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. Apart from his ministry in North America, Dr. Tennent teaches annually at the Luther W. New Junior Theological College of Dehradun, India, where he has served as an adjunct professor since 1989. He has over the years ministered and taught in China, in Thailand, in Nigeria, and Eastern Europe. In addition, he serves the Global Church in his capacity as chair of the Lausanne Theology Working Group, and it is my privilege to work with him in that capacity. Dr. Tennent is author of several books, including Building Christianity on Indian Foundations, Christianity at the Religious Roundtable, Theology in the Context of World Christianity, and a missiology textbook, Invitation to World Missions, a missiology for the 21st century. He is a co-author of Revitalizing Practice, a book published in 2008 about challenges to theological education in North America. I'm sure, like me, you are looking forward to his keynote address tonight on the topic, Theological Education in the Context of World Christianity. So without further delay, ladies and gentlemen, please help me to welcome Dr. Tennent to the podium.
Thank you very much, Mark, and it is an honor and delight to be here. I'm so thankful to Sam Logan, to Doug Birdsall for this kind invitation, and it's good to be back at Gordon-Conwell, Dr. Hollinger. It's nice to be back here again. We're gathered together here this week because of two remarkable developments in world Christianity. First, the rise of global Christianity and the rediscovery of Christianity as a post-Western faith. This first theme has been well rehearsed and documented in the writings of Andrew Walls, Laman Sané, and Todd Johnson. I refer in particular to Andrew Walls' collection of essays in his book, The Missionary Movement in Christian History, and his The Cross-Cultural Process in Christian History, Laman Sané's Whose Religion is Christianity, and the excellent demographic work in Todd Johnson and Kenneth Ross's Atlas of Global Christianity, and of course, the World Christian Encyclopedia. It's also come into the broader consciousness of Christians around the world through the rather important and popular writings of Philip Jenkins, The Next Christendom, The New Faces of Christianity, as well as by Samuel Escobar in his book, The New Global Mission, The Gospel from Everywhere to Everyone, among others. The second remarkable development is the emergence of the West as the fastest growing mission field in the world and the collapse of Christendom. A few have documented this more carefully than Elijah Kim in his recent 2012 book, The Rise of the Global South, The Decline of Western Christendom and the Rise of Majority World Christianity. We must, of course, appreciate the real differences between the European story of Christianity and the North American story. If you compare, for example, Peter Berger's work, Religious America, Secular Europe, and Philip Jenkins, again, popular work, God's Continent. Nevertheless, these two developments are the most important twin shifts of the 20th century, which continue to have profound implications for theological education throughout the world. Never before in history have the richest theological resources, books, libraries, endowment, developed faculties, found themselves situated squarely inside an emerging mission field. Furthermore, we have to go back to the work of 16th century reformers in Europe and in the remarkable expansion of the church through the work of Jesuits in Latin America to find a time when the church was growing so rapidly in a context where access to theological education was under such strain. And Martin Luther, for example, once lamented that many of his pastors did not know the Ten Commandments. In fact, he said if he could find one who did, he would make him a pastor. And many of us involved in church planting movements can echo those sentiments. This gathering represents a rather unique opportunity to reflect on these two twin challenges, the emergence of global Christianity and the collapse of Christendom, and to think how together we can reposition ourselves, our institutions, our faculties, our curriculum in light of them. It would, of course, be a gross overstatement to presume that all of the institutions gathered here, both in the majority world as well as in the West, have been unreflective or unresponsive to these powerful forces. On the contrary, most of us have thought about these realities quite a bit. Each of us, in varying ways, have been implementing, even if haltingly, various strategic responses. However, we've not had sufficient opportunity to talk about them together in a public forum like this. We have 33 majority world leaders here, 31 Western leaders here, all heads of institutions or major leaders in accrediting bodies. It's a remarkable emergence of this event together Lausanne brings together. Nor have we, as leaders, really reached a consensus to what best practices even looks like. Curriculum change, faculty hires, global partnerships, changing pedagogy and learning styles, budgetary realities, accreditation challenges, and new degree goals are inevitably fraught with institutional inertia, resistance, and innumerable theological issues which make this transition exceedingly difficult. We have, of course, not only ATS represented here through Dan Elshire, we have ATA here, we have ACTEA from Africa, EEAA from Europe, and of course ICETE, all represented in this room. The purpose of this address tonight is to try to frame this issue in historical context and set forth at least some of the key issues before us as leaders and provide a context for the listening and learning which we hope will take place in the days ahead. Although this is a Lausanne event, I thought it would be remiss, and this came up in our conversations in the planning stage, if we didn't really at least acknowledge historically the fascinating history this event has had in the conversation which brings this event together in the Association of Theological Schools, which, by the way, is mirrored largely in the conversations with ICETE, ATA, and AAA, and so other organizations. I think, in fact, if we don't acknowledge this here as Lausanne people, I think it would be greatly undermine our long-term strategic work as leaders. I could point out quite a few gatherings and initiatives. Many of you were there for them. I'd like to go back to 1986 and the 35th biennial meeting of the ATS, which declared the 1990s the decade of globalization. The 1986 meeting was held under the theme, quote, Global Challenges and Perspectives in Theological Education. Anybody here in the 1986 meeting? We have Sam. God bless you, Sam. You're our historian for the night. The keynote address was given by Kenyan Cardinal Lorenze, followed by a number of distinguished leaders in theological education. Now, these addresses were later published in the spring and autumn issues of Theological Education 1986. Cardinal Lorenze's keynote address focused on how the forces of globalization demand that we remember anew the universality of the Christian faith, something we talk about a lot. It was a call, in some respects, to de-Westernize Christianity. That was a theme in his message. The address began with a theological clarion call to take notice of what was happening on the global scene. He went on to point out six specific challenges that he believed we would face in the years that lay ahead. And I think it's just helpful in 2012 to look back on 1986 and what they believed at that time to be the six most looming challenges in order to achieve globalization. I'll just list them. First, the lack of information. Second, the poor communication among various religious bodies around the world. Third, the stiff resistance to change in institutional structures of academia. Well, can you imagine that? Fourth, the demands of time and finance on institutional structures, a passing problem. Fifth, reminded us of the priority of seminaries to prepare pastors for specific confessional bodies. And finally, he noted with alarm the growing disconnect between seminaries and divinity schools and historic Christian faith, which had produced what he called, I'm quoting the Cardinal Renze, religious indifferentism and theological eclecticism. Now, in response to these problems, Cardinal Renze called for a greater exchange of international students, a closer relationship between seminaries, divinity schools, and the church, and a deeper appreciation for the cultural context out of which theological reflection arises, and a more intentional capacity to dialogue as Christians with those from other religious affiliations. Now, today we stand 26 years later, and we see that some of these concerns have been met, or at least reframed, by the research and writing noted earlier, and major advances in global communication, and the emergence of what we would call today the standalone evangelical seminaries or informal church kind of training programs, which produce most of our pastors today. Yet several of these concerns would be as relevant today as they were 26 years ago. Resistance to change, limitation of finances and resources, all these are just as relevant today as they were 26 years ago. Orenze's address was followed by three responses from across the theological spectrum. And those papers were later published in one of the editions. And then there was also a large group of case studies brought together, also published in Theological Education, from the following schools. And these were all schools asked to produce case studies, how they're responding to changes in global Christianity. Atlanta Theological Association, Claremont School of Theology, Denver, Fuller, Gordon-Conwell, Harvard Divinity School, Lutheran School of Theology in Chicago, Princeton Theological Seminary, St. Vincent de Paul, Seventh-day Adventist, Southwestern Baptist, Toronto School of Theology, and Union in New York. No Asbury there, by the way. Now, if you read these case studies, as I've done, you really get the sense that in 1986, the ATS was like in the first inning of a baseball game, or to use a more global analogy, the first over of a cricket match. Okay, the opening minutes of a soccer game. Seminaries were just beginning to warm up to the real challenges which we face and are now in full force tonight as we gather here. Much of it, if you look at what they really had in their programs and their ideas and suggestions and all the case studies, it was most of what we would call today window dressing, symbolic type change. In fact, David Schuller, looking back on it years later, made the following statement. He said, "At the beginning, we naively thought the adoption of a few courses on world Christianity, or I'm sorry, world religions, the enlargement of bibliographies to include more theologians from South America, Africa, and Asia, greater sensitivity to women, and a few more sabbaticals in the third world would solve the problem." Most schools, in other words, were involved in technical changes, not adaptive transformation. And by the way, seminaries and academics in particular, we are famous for technical change because our whole life is about fixing problems, drilling down to, you know, the end of the earth on a particular subject, and sometimes not able to see the larger adaptive challenges. We now stand at halftime. We recognize that the more adaptive changes are necessary if we're to really engage the global church. There are new players on the field. There are new dynamics, global dynamics occurring, new voices being heard in a way unimaginable in 1986. Now, I'll not highlight, because it's after supper and you've already had dessert, the 37 issues of Theology Education, which dealt over the years with various aspects of this conversation. Do I hear an amen? However, if we move 13 years later to 1999, the spring issue of Theology Education, we find an excellent summary of where most schools, they were given kind of a 13-year update. And after the 86 meeting, you find that it was a lot more nuanced, a lot more really interesting discussions, and a more appreciation of the profound challenges that we actually face. A task force on globalization was set up in 86, connected to a Pew grant, and as a result, a 12-year initiative to better understand best practices regarding globalization even though by that time the term globalization had been eclipsed by better language. It nevertheless gave space for better dialogue and reflection, and the conversation expanded beyond discussion of economic and social forces to really, I think, for the first time, more sustained theological reflection about what we're actually facing in the presence of the global church, and one that was not dominated by Western theological institutions and traditions. The findings were eventually published in spring of 1999. The issue was entitled Incarnating Globalization, ATS Schools, Issues, Experience, Understandings, and Challenges, far more nuanced, and demonstrated for the first time there was a real readiness, I think, for adaptive change. William Lesher, Donald Shriver's article called Stumbling in the Right Direction, rightly pointed out that in 1986, what was regarded with suspicion was now a, quote, commanding fact of life. Nevertheless, the decade-long conversation demonstrated how difficult it was to negotiate this change. A few examples will suffice. First, the discussion did bring together a lot more voices to the table. Yet at the same time, it vacated so much of the discussion on internationalism and ecumenism which preceded it, which completely got shelved on the side. Second, it became clear that the global church was far more connected to historic Christianity than many schools in the ATS, which had long abandoned a clear commitment to proclamation, evangelism, and church planting, all of which seemed to be natural expressions of the church with huge implications for training and ministerial preparation. It's where Lausanne will play a huge role. It revealed a divide in what a seminary was tasked to do, which cut much deeper than the standard debate between classical critical training and practical ministry preparation. Third, in the ensuing years, it became clear that the age-old dichotomy of local and global no longer made sense, even for evangelicals who had long accepted the notion of a so-called Christian West, and the mission field located somewhere outside the West became totally untenable, especially with the rapidly growing African, Latino, Hispanic, Asian churches in the Western world. Everywhere, of course, Europeans in diaspora, North America, Australia, South Africa, and wherever, are in decline, but not so other groups in those places. It became clear that the growing respect for other cultures, the quest for humanization, seemed to be in conflict with evangelistic goals of the church, which for many in the West seem out of sync with the evangelistic mission of the church. The theme, it became clear, went much deeper than a classic conversation between the so-called social gospel and the evangelistic mandate. Scholarly empathetic research about world religions, for example, seemed to be on a collision course with the vibrant gospel-proclaiming church planting initiatives which were bubbling up all over the world. As Peter Berger, the eminent sociologist here in Boston, noted, quote, "The secularization theory is essentially mistaken, because the assumption that we live in a secularized world is false." And Berger goes on to say that the key assumption of secularization theory, which insisted that, quote, "modernization necessarily leads to a decline of religion, both in society and the minds of individuals," I'm quoting him here, "turned out to be wrong," end quote. The West, meanwhile, was emerging as a mission field, as evidenced by a new virulent stream of atheism, popularized by books like Richard Dawkins's The God Delusion, Sam Harris's Letters to a Christian Nation, End of Faith, etc. However, the larger movement has been a movement toward a dizzying array of new and old spiritualities, all of this happening under the shadow of the emergence of a vibrant majority world Christianity. This, as noted earlier, is the great new fact of our time. So in light of this, tonight, where do we go from here? I'd like to suggest four areas of which will be discussed in various workshops and presentations which will come before this body in the days ahead. First, we must have a serious retooling of our faculties so they become acquainted with scholarship emerging from the majority world. It is not enough to simply sprinkle into our faculties scholars we recruit from around the world, which carries its own serious missiological problems. By the way, that's true for majority world scholars recruited for the Western institutions, as well as Western scholars brought into majority world institutions. We've got to go beyond that. All of our faculties must become globally conversant scholars. In my own research I published in Theology and Context of World Christianity, I discovered rich themes being written about by majority world scholars, which moved global Christianity from being a hyphenated theology, think about Dalit theology, African theology, Minjung theology, or on and on, or some other specialized version of indigenous reflection, to a rich, textured contribution of theology in its own right. We are clearly beyond the day when Western scholarship is viewed as the only non-hyphenated theology. That is, theology without the adjective assumes the priority of Western scholarship. I discovered remarkable insights into the atonement from Korean scholars, Christological insights from African scholars, which promises to shape the very fabric of how theology is taught all over the world, not just in indigenous-specific context. John Abiti, considered one of the pioneers of African theology, once lamented how Africans had dutifully traveled to the eminent European and North American theological institutions for higher studies without finding any corresponding interest in their own theological reflections. Abiti said, and I quote, "We have eaten theology with you. We have drunk theology with you. We have dreamed theology with you. But it's all been one-sided. It has been, in one sense, your theology. We know you theologically. The question is, do you know us theologically? Would you like to know us theologically?" The answer up to now is that we really haven't wanted to know much about the theological reflections of majority world Christians. Vidi went on to point out that it is, quote, "utterly scandalous for students of Western theology to know more about the theology of heretics long dead than they do about the living theology of hundreds of millions of living Africans today." Clearly, the borders of theological discourse can no longer afford to stay within the familiar perimeter of Western discourse. Second, we must engage in a new level of partnership which is fully bidirectional. In the past, partnerships meant we provide the funding and you do what we direct you to do. I remember I don't know if Doug's thought on this would be, but I think how many of you were present at the 2004 Pattaya, Thailand, Lausanne conference there? Quite a few were there. In my mind, one of the great benefits of that consultation, that Lausanne event, was actually a very healthy discussion on partnership. And to me, that was a turning point in the Lausanne movement. Today, we must have greater bilateral exchanges based on relationships and shared vision. The notice that all real education takes place in the West must be replaced by a new era of mutuality and shared vision with seminaries and training institutes around the world. I think a couple examples, churches that had never had Christendom can actually instruct us how to live in post-Christendom. Think about the amazing benefits of learning about evangelism, church planting. Think about another example, the ability to overcome what David Tracy calls the three fatal separations in the Western culture, which the majority of the world can help us with: the separation of feeling and thought, of form and content, and theory and practice. Now, Asbury, and many of you as well, have entered into a wide range of partnerships which are truly bidirectional: faculty exchanges, student classroom exchanges, even strengthening library holdings of our partner institutions. One way of moving to a new platform of engagement with Global Theological Education, which moves us beyond the kind of competitive posture we've inhabited in recent decades. Third, our own seminaries and divinity schools must regain our missional footing. In the past, seminaries in the West have focused on two primary outcomes, namely, training pastors and training teachers. That's what we did best. But this is a Christendom paradigm. It no longer makes sense, and is why the missional churches are opting not to send their young leaders to seminary. We must train, in addition to pastors and teachers, of course, but we must train also culturally savvy, theologically nuanced evangelists and church planters. We must release new kinds of apostolic leadership, which oversees massive new lay-empowered Christian movements in North America, in the West, and all over the majority world in partnerships. We must adopt new degree goals and delivery systems which can carry this new mandate. We must move beyond a vision limited to credentialing for ordination to equipping for ministry. Fourth, finally, we must move to a new economic viability model. Now, most of us do not currently serve institutions with a sustainable economic model. We're driven by the market, by tuition revenue. We've engaged in endless red ocean strategies, which implies increasing competition for ever-diminishing pools of students. Rather than a blue ocean strategy, which identifies vast groups of people who are not seeking ordination or even traditional ministerial roles, but who are hungry for training and how it applies to the marketplace. And even in the early church, North Africa, and the 50 bishops, most of them were bivocational, even the bishops of the early church. I've taught in a theological institution in India for 25 years. It'd be unthinkable in that context to think that equipping the next generation of leadership for such a growing, vibrant church in North India could be sustained by limiting pastoral leadership to those with an equivalent of an MDiv degree or BD degree. The MDiv degree, of course, is vitally important and will continue to be for the foreseeable future. I've lived through, I think, at least three versions of the MDiv is dead. Many of us can remember all these. I think it'll be a very important degree, but I think it must be supplemented with new levels of training for a broader base of Christians who no longer have the benefit of church and family catechesis and training background. Further, the notion that a student can come to seminary, pack his or her bags for 2 or 3 years for a lifetime journey, in my mind, is no longer viable. We need new lifelong learning models which equip people in discrete degree and certificate programs, as well as ongoing training and retooling in the midst of ministry. We must launch new kinds of platforms for delivering theological education around the world. In conclusion, this is a kairos moment in the history of Western theological education and also majority world education. It involves moving beyond the kind of chronos orientation towards time, which is framed by semesters and academic calendars. Instead, we must recapture a whole new vision of our time in the history of the church. This involves new kinds of leadership, which leads us to new models of education and faculty deployment. There are many new faces in the Christian church which demand nothing less. If we listen to these voices and take seriously the kairos of our own generation, then we can move joyfully from the Ichabod of despair to the Emmanuel of hope and promise. The impossibilities which cross our desk every day must be reframed by the new possibilities which Christ gives to his church. The whole incarnation is framed by two impossibilities made possible, a virgin womb and an empty tomb. As Peter Larson has noted, Jesus entered the world through a door marked no entrance, a virgin womb. He left the world through a door marked no exit, a tomb of death. As we grapple with the painful realities of this broken creation, we cannot forget the deeper reality of the inbreaking of the new creation, whose signs and pointers can be found at every turn. As theological educators, we stand at the vanguard of a whole new day in helping to form, shape, and direct the future of theological education in the church. To do so, we must become more globally astute, more culturally savvy, more theologically nuanced, and more missionally driven. And I can think of no better network of Christians to help facilitate this new day globally than Lausanne. Thank you very much.